bom dia. Solicitamos a todos que ocupem os seus lugares e aos portadores de telefone celular a gentileza de desligarem os seus aparelhos ou mantê-los em modo silencioso. Obrigada. O cerimonial da Universidade de Brasília tem o prazer e a honra em dar início à cerimônia de abertura da palestra com o Prêmio Nobel de Química do ano de 2004, Dr. Aaron Ciechanover. Este evento é uma realização da Nobel Prize e AstraZeneca, em parceria com a Universidade de Brasília, e conta com o apoio da Associação dos Docentes da Universidade de Brasília, ADUMB. Para compor a mesa desta solenidade, convidamos diretor executivo da área médica da AstraZeneca Brasil, senhor Marcelo Horácio. Diretor científico da Nobel Media, senhor Adam Smith. Ministra da Embaixada do Reino Unido no Brasil, excelentíssima senhora Liz Davison. E a reitora da Universidade de Brasília, professora Márcia Abraão Moura. Gostaríamos de agradecer e registrar a presença do assistente de pesquisa da Embaixada da Suécia em Brasília, excelentíssimo Pedro Lima. Embaixador do Estado Plurinacional da Bolívia, excelentíssimo senhor José Kim Franco. Ministro conselheiro da Delegação da União Europeia no Brasil, excelentíssimo senhor Alejandro Zurita. Ministra conselheira da Embaixada de El Salvador, excelentíssima senhora Marcela Rendeiros. Representando a presidência do Conselho Regional de Medicina do Distrito Federal, doutor Alexandre Cavalca Tavares. E o presidente da Associação dos Docentes da UNB, professor Virgílio Caixeta Arraes. Gostaríamos ainda de agradecer a presença de todos os decanos, diretores e coordenadores de faculdades e institutos da Universidade de Brasília, além de professores e servidores. Para dar as boas-vindas aos presentes, convidamos para tomar a palavra o diretor executivo da área médica da AstraZeneca Brasil, senhor Marcelo Horácio.
Bom dia, pessoal. É com grande prazer que eu estou aqui hoje. Em primeiro lugar, não sei se todos sabem, mas eu fui professor universitário por 20 anos na Universidade do Rio de Janeiro. Então, voltar ao ambiente universitário é uma coisa que é muito preciosa para mim. E agora, em nome da AstraZeneca, eu queria agradecer à Universidade de Brasília por nos dar a oportunidade de trazer o Nobel Prize esse ano. Aqui é o professor Aaron para falar sobre ubiquitina. O Prêmio Nobel Initiative é um prêmio que já vem sendo organizado desde 2014 aqui no Brasil. A UNB tem participado dos três primeiros anos e tem sido um grande sucesso. Além da UNB, outras universidades como a USP, institutos importantes como a Fiocruz, o Instituto Nacional do Câncer, também tem tido oportunidade dessa interação. Então, eu espero que todos tenham um grande evento, que aproveitem a oportunidade, porque, mais do que a ciência per se, é a inspiração que nos traz um grande pesquisador como o professor Aron, em termos de jornada da sua vida. Então, mais uma vez, agradecer e celebrar junto com vocês o aniversário, o 55º aniversário da Universidade de Brasília. Muito obrigado, em nome da AstraZeneca, e tenham um bom evento.
Passamos a palavra ao diretor científico da Nobel Media, senhor Adam Smith.
Thank you very much indeed. Good morning, everybody. On behalf of everybody at Nobel Media, I'd like to welcome you to this morning's lecture, which, as you see, is part of the Nobel Prize Inspiration Initiative. This is a collaboration between Nobel Media and AstraZeneca that has been running since 2010. And it's designed to take Nobel laureates around the world to meet audiences, especially of young people, all over the world. So far, we've visited South Korea and China and Japan and India and Russia and lots of countries in Europe and the US, and as Marcello says, Brazil 3 times. And it's a real delight to be back here for the 3rd time at UNB. And I'd like to thank you very, very much for hosting us again. And I'd like to say what a delight it is to see such a full auditorium. It's fantastic. You know, it's such a good thing. I'd like to take a photograph of you all, and I want to send that photograph back to Stockholm to show them what this initiative is all about. So please say Nobel Prize, all of you. Fantastic. Good. You know, I'm going to take another one. You're so good. This is just what we want. Lovely. Thank you. Nobel Prize. Fantastic. Thank you. So, as Marcello said, we really encourage you to listen closely to Aaron's words, both to get his own scientific story and the inspiration that he can bring. And afterwards, we're going to have quite a long period, I hope, for quick Q&A. And I really encourage you, especially the younger people in the audience, ask questions. Okay. With that, I'd like to let things begin.
Informamos que a UNB TV está transmitindo o evento pelo Facebook, com o público acompanhando também a transmissão pelo Anfiteatro 10 da Universidade de Brasília. E aqueles que quiserem acompanhar a tradução simultânea, a AstraZeneca disponibilizou uma cabine na área externa do auditório para que todos possam acompanhar tanto a palestra quanto a apresentação. Com a palavra, a ministra da Embaixada do Reino Unido no Brasil, excelentíssima senhora Liz Davidson.
Good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to be here at UNIB on behalf of the British Embassy. The exchange of experiences and information between the UK and Brazil in the health sector has been very important for several decades in both the public and the private sectors. In the private sector, there are several UK players making an important contribution to Brazil's development at the moment, and AstraZeneca is a fantastic example of this with its investments in innovation and R&D. In the public sector, the UK government offers scholarships for master's degrees through its Chevening programme, allowing Brazilians to acquire know-how and expertise from British institutions, and applications are now open. We have also supported AstraZeneca's efforts in establishing scientific collaborations with partners in Brazil, for example, a programme for postdoctorates in the UK. I welcome the collaboration that has brought us here today with UNIB and the Nobel Prize Inspiration Initiative, and I'm very, very much looking forward to our discussion with Dr. Aaron Cicinova. Thank you very much.
Ouviremos agora a magnífica reitora da Universidade de Brasília, professora Márcia Abraão.
Bom dia. Acho que assim está melhor. Bom dia, agradeço e parabenizo a iniciativa, a presença de todos. Agradeço particularmente o doutor Cicinova, treinei algumas vezes, para a Universidade de Brasília. Bom, dou também as boas-vindas às autoridades presentes, decanos, toda a comunidade, também os membros da sociedade que conseguiram entrar. Infelizmente, ainda tem gente de fora, mas o que é muito bom, porque mostra como a ciência ainda une a sociedade. No Brasil, as principais pesquisas são feitas nas universidades públicas, nas universidades federais e estaduais. Mesmo com muitas dificuldades ao longo dos anos, nós continuamos fazendo pesquisa de alto nível. A Universidade de Brasília é uma das principais universidades do Brasil e da América Latina. É uma universidade que tem mais de 100 programas de pós-graduação, 150 programas de pós-graduação, 40 mil alunos de graduação, 8 mil alunos de pós-graduação, 150 cursos de graduação, uma universidade que tem nota máxima nos indicadores acadêmicos no país e uma universidade que ainda não tem um prêmio Nobel. Queremos que iniciativas como estas sejam motivadoras para os nossos cientistas, para os nossos professores, para os nossos estudantes, para que a sociedade de Brasília, a sociedade brasileira, cada vez se interessem mais pela ciência, que vejam na ciência e na universidade o local, a forma de fazer a mudança do mundo. Por isso, para nós, é fundamental eventos como este. Já falei para o Dr. Adam Smith que gostaríamos de ter um evento deste por ano na Universidade de Brasília. Estamos à disposição para trazer um prêmio Nobel para a UNB todos os anos. Também dentro de um esforço de internacionalização, de aumentar as parcerias com os nossos parceiros internacionais. Por isso, este evento é fundamental e espero que todos aproveitem ao máximo, que tirem daqui a motivação para continuar as pesquisas e para continuar fazendo a diferença no país e no mundo, como a Universidade de Brasília tem feito nesses 55 anos. Tenham um excelente evento.
Neste momento, desfaz-se a mesa de abertura. Agradecemos a presença das autoridades que a compuseram e solicitamos que retornem aos seus lugares na plateia. Para ministrar a palestra, o sistema proteolítico Ubiquitina, de mecanismos básicos a doenças humanas até o desenvolvimento de medicamentos, convidamos ao palco o Prêmio Nobel de Química do ano de 2004, Dr. Aaron Cichanover.
Good morning or good afternoon. It's wonderful to see such a packed hall. Really exciting. What I want to do with you today is to tell you the story of the discovery of the ubiquitin system. And I think it's an interesting story that starts with curiosity, with asking a question, first identifying a question, then putting the system, the experimental system, together, and the end, or it's not the end, actually now we are at another beginning, is the development of numerous drugs that are already in use worldwide that are saving the lives and improving the quality of life of millions of people around the world. So it's a long story. We shall make it very short. The story lasts for almost 40 years. I started my journey in the mid-70s. So now we are already in 2017. So almost 40 years we are in the business. But it's an interesting one. So I shall try to use less of a jargon and just give you the principles of the discovery and what it entails. So what you see here is my city, the city of Haifa. I don't know if anybody heard about it. It's a small city of 250,000 people on the very east side of the Mediterranean. It's a beautiful city with a rolling mountain. It has the Baha'i Center, the World Baha'i Center in it. And the medical school is, the medical school is the left, on the very left side there, this white building. And the story is the story of protein degradation, how proteins are degraded in the cells, how we are destroying our own proteins. And the question was, at the very beginning, whether proteins are destroyed at all. And people assumed for many years, for many decades, that we are born as babies, weighing 2, 3, 4 kilograms, and then we are growing up, and at the age of 16 or 17 or 18, attaining our final weight, and then we are carrying all our proteins all along the way until we pass away. So, as you know, the proteins are extremely important components of our body. Basically, all our functions are mediated via proteins. Me standing in front of you, the muscles, the hemoglobin that carries oxygen, the digestive tract, the kidneys, the lung, everything, the brain, everything is working on proteins. The DNA is important, but the DNA has the information to encode for proteins. But the play is being, the game is being played by proteins. So that's, and proteins, as you know, are very sensitive. They are sensitive to mutations, of course. They are sensitive to irradiation. They are sensitive to temperature. Think about if you are leaving a piece of meat on the table for a few hours, it's gone. You cannot use it anymore. But nevertheless, our meat, which is very identical to the meat that we are eating, except that the meat that we are eating is derived from a different animal, from the cow, or from the chicken, or from the fish, is coming from a dead body. While our meat is in a live body, but we are living in 37 degrees, which is deleterious for proteins. We don't think about it. But 37 degrees is deleterious for proteins, and therefore our proteins are kept on being damaged all the time as we speak. And therefore, there is a must that we shall be equipped with a mechanism that will remove all the time online the damaged proteins. Think about living in 21% of oxygen. We don't think about it. But actually, the elements of life, which are both temperature and oxygen, are also the most deleterious elements of life. So there is an internal balance between the need to live at high temperature. Why 37? Why we are not living at 4 degrees or at 5 degrees? 37 was picked up by evolution as an optimal temperature in order to carry out optimally all the biochemical reactions. And the same for the atmosphere that we are enjoying here, but at the same time, those two elements are extremely toxic to our proteins, and therefore nature had to evolve along evolution a very sophisticated machinery that will remove proteins that are damaged by temperature, by oxygen, by mutation, by many other factors. But this is not the whole story. We also have to remove proteins that are not necessary anymore. So they may be functional, they may be healthy, but we nevertheless have to remove them. Think about the winter, we get flu, we are raising antibodies, we defeat the virus, and then what we are doing with the antibodies? Living with them until next winter? No, we remove them because we don't need them. We are not only removing the antibodies, but we are removing also the transcription factors that transcribe those antibodies. And the same is true for Many processes. Think about cell cycle. Cells are dividing all the time in our body. So the division of the cells is driven by proteins. Everything in the body is being spoken in the protein's language. Basically, that's the language that nature is speaking. So think about cells that are dividing. They are what we call the gas proteins and the brake proteins. Think about the car. What we are using in the car in order to drive it, except for the steering wheel, we are using the gas and the brake. Some of us have also stereo systems in the car. But otherwise, the most important controls are the gas and the brake. So they are the gas proteins that drive the cell to divide. But once the cell is divided, we have to stop it. Otherwise, it will divide non-stop and lead to cancer. So we are removing, we are destroying those proteins, the gas proteins, which are healthy and functional. But we don't want them to function anymore. And we are synthesizing brake proteins. And we stop the cell division. And then when the cell has to divide again, we kill. We destroy the brake protein and we elicit again. We resynthesize the gas protein and so on and so forth. So there are many reasons why we have to be dynamic and to destroy proteins that are either damaged or we just, they fulfilled, completed the functions and we don't need them anymore. Now, what about numbers? How much a day? A lot. We are destroying every day between 5 to 7% of our proteins. 5 to 7%. That means that within 20 days or 30 days, we are removing all our proteins. Well, it's not exactly like that because some of the proteins we are recycling several times in an hour, transcription factors. We are recycling several times in an hour, but and some proteins are very long-lived, like hemoglobin, that lives for 120 days. But on the average, I can tell you that we are replacing ourselves once in 2 to 3 months. So what is today? Today is the 10th of August. So I can tell you that on 10th of May, each and every one of you, including myself, was built from completely different proteins than we are built today. It's just an image that we look in the mirror every morning and we see the same face. But chemistry will tell us that it's not the same face. If we'll send the sample from the proteins of today to the laboratory, and there are many ways to do these experiments, and the chemist will tell us that the proteins of today are different by 7% than the proteins of yesterday, and so on and so forth. This dynamics raises very interesting questions. If I am not today what I used to be 3 months ago, then who am I anyway? It's a very funny, but at the same time, awfully serious question, because I believe, and you believe, that you are today about the same that you were 3 months ago. You love the same persons, you have the same memory, maybe in meanwhile you have new memories, you traveled abroad, you brought new memories, you forgot some others, but basically, we are the same. So how is it that we are changing the hardware, but we nevertheless remain the same? This is a very important biological question that we still don't understand. There are many answers to that, or many hypotheses. Why we are the same, nevertheless that we are not the same. Because think about your computer. If your computer is broken, and you are going to buy exactly the same computer, you need to move the software from the old one to the new one, because the new one doesn't know anything about the old one. But we keep on carrying our software with us despite the fact that we are changing the hardware constantly. This is not a simple biological question at all. But that's the fact, and we shall not deal with the philosophy of it, but we shall go rather to the fundamental mechanism. Nowadays, without going into too many details, there are three major mechanisms of destruction. It was not appreciated several decades ago. People didn't pay much attention to destruction. You know, the world was mesmerized by the central dogma of biology, by the genetic code, why we are human beings and not cats or dogs, how the information is being transmitted from generation to generation, and the central dogma of the information that flows from DNA to RNA to proteins basically occupies the entire scientific community. And very few people cared about destruction. Nowadays, destruction have rise to stardomship, and it occupies an equal place, I would say. Well, it's hard to compare to construction, and we understand that construction is very much dependent on destruction. We are renewing ourselves non-stop, and there are many. There are three systems that are involved in destruction. All of them were awarded the Nobel Prize. One of them, two Nobel Prizes, even different aspect. So one of them is the lysosome and autophagy. The lysosome was the Nobel Prize that was awarded to Christian de Dive in the mid-70s. And then a year ago, on autophagy, on another function of the lysosome, to Yoshinori Osumi from Japan. Apoptosis got the Nobel Prize in 2002, and then ubiquitin, that we are going to talk about, got the Nobel Prize in 2004. So that's also a testimony to the recognition of the whole machinery of destruction. So let's talk a little bit about why we are degrading proteins. We were talking about quality control and about control of processes. And the founding father of the field, the real founding father, was a German Jew working in the United States, because he was fired from his job in Freiburg in Germany upon the rise of the Nazis to power and moved to New York, to Columbia University, Rudolf Schenheimer. And Rudolf found that proteins are indeed dynamic, that they change. He didn't know anything about the mechanism. He just described the phenomenon. And by doing simple isotopic labeling, he took rats and he gave them to eat labeled amino acids, and he found that the amino acids are incorporated into proteins and then gradually are phasing out. So they go in and out. So he described the phenomenon that he called the dynamic state of proteins or of macromolecules. He did it also for sugars, for lipids, for other components. He died early on and he didn't see the implications of his major discovery. And then came Christian de Dive, that I mentioned already, and he discovered the lysosome. So he was a Belgian scientist working initially in Leuven in Belgium, and then moved to United States, to New York, to Rockefeller University, and he discovered the lysosome. And the lysosome, as you all know, is an organelle inside the cell that digests, has enzymes that destroy everything. They destroy nucleic acid, they destroy lipids, they destroy proteins, they destroy sugars. But the lysosome turns out not to be specific. So the lysosome is acting, it's very hard to see the green pointer. But if you see the left arrow on the left lower corner of the picture, you will see that what the lysosome is doing, the lysosome pinches off droplets of the cytosol. So it kind of swallows, like drinking, the cytosol and engulfs them into vacuoles. You see the vacuoles in the upper right arrow, and these vacuoles open up and pour the contents of the cytosol into the lysosome to be degraded. Now this by nature cannot be specific. You can imagine that if I walk here with a nylon bag and collect air everywhere here in the hall, it will be the air, the same air that is made of oxygen, of nitrogen, of carbon dioxide. There will be basically no difference, unless I will take air directly from your expiration that will have a little bit more of carbon dioxide. But the cytosol contains all the 20,000 proteins in the cytosol, in the cell. So all of them will be destroyed. So there is no selectivity. But Christian de Dive didn't think about it, or he thought about it but didn't have an answer. And when we walked into the system in the mid-70s, we thought that the lysosome is only a partial answer to the destructive processes. There must be something else. The lysosome is okay. It degrades protein in a non-selective manner when the cell is starving, under stress, but something is still missing. And what is missing is a mechanism that is highly specific. You can imagine now in the cell that there are billions of molecules of proteins of different species. There are 20,000 different proteins, but each has million molecules, or 2 million, or 10 million, doesn't matter. Any enzyme has many millions of molecules. And you can imagine that one of them, just one of them, get now denatured by irradiation, by ultraviolet irradiation. And you need to pick it up, one single molecule, you have to pick it up and catch it and degrade it. Or the cell finished its division, and out of the 20,000 proteins, only cyclin A needs to be degraded. Out of 20,000, all the molecules of cyclin A have to be degraded at one moment in order to stop cell cycle. You need a very highly selective mechanism to pick up one of billions or one population out of 20,000 different populations in order to carry out this function. So there must be a very sophisticated mechanism, and the mechanism must be cytosolic. It cannot be an organelle, because there must be some policemen that will run around all around the cell and will pick up the single thief that is kind of rotating or floating around. So we knew that there must be something missing. We knew that it must be highly specific, and we knew that it must be soluble. It can be an organelle, it can be a lysosome. It must be floating all over. It must have access, a license, to access every compartment in the cell. So with these assumptions, and that also already tells you a lesson that whenever you pick up a biological question, you have to maybe devote more time to think about it than to solve it. Because once you have the question in mind, the solution is kind of easy. Then you put a system and you solve it. But thinking about the problem and being convinced that it exists and knowing exactly where to go is a key issue, I think, in the biological thinking process. So once we finish that stage of sitting in the library, identifying all the milestones, we were on the way, and we picked up the red blood cell, the mature red blood cells. Both Avram Hershko, my mentor, and myself are physicians, so we thought of a system that is more related to medicine. And this is the red, the young red blood cell, the reticulocyte. And why the reticulocyte? Because of two reasons. So I think, again, I'm going back to the thinking of biology. First of all, you have to identify a question. But then you have to identify the ideal system in order to solve it experimentally. Because everybody can tell me a question. Yes, one question in biology is to solve the problem of cancer. So what? Can you do it? No, you cannot, because you don't have a good biological system. Or one question that bothers everybody is getting old. People want to live not 100 years, but 200 years. That's a nice question. But how do we do it? We don't know yet. So the issue is to ask the right question, and then to ask yourself whether the question is solvable with currently available experimental tools. So that's the second stage that you are doing. So you know, you have to think of biology in a little bit broader way in order to be, I wouldn't say successful, but in order to really make head-on progress. So we took these red young blood cells. Why? One, because it doesn't have a lysosome anymore. It expelled it on the way to differentiation. So you're out of background. Because typically what happens is that the noise is much stronger than the signal. So the signal is buried underneath the background noise. You know, if there is a big noise around it and somebody plays a violin, you cannot hear the violin because there is so much noise. So the lysosome will degrade also proteins, so we wanted to be in a lysosome-free environment. The other reason why we picked up the lysosome, the reticulocyte, was that it degrades all its machineries in a very short time. Because if you take the mature red blood cell, it's a very primitive cell. It is nothing. It has hemoglobin, the red important protein that carries oxygen from the lungs to all the tissues, and then carries carbon dioxide outside of the tissues to be expired outside of our body. So it's a very important protein, but it has very few other proteins. It doesn't have a nucleus, it doesn't have mitochondria, it doesn't have all the machineries. It has very few machineries just to make some energy and to keep its flexibility of the membrane. So we knew that the liaison one will not bother us with the background, and two, it already degrades protein. So we thought this will be an ideal cell, and indeed, we found it there. And we published the first paper in 1978. This was my first. This is the founding paper of the ubiquitin system, and I want to point out 2 points about this paper. One, the journal that it was published is BBRC, it's Biochemical Biophysical Research Communication. It's a very low impact journal. It has nothing, you know, people don't publish there today a lot, and it's kind of a neglected journal because everybody is, you know, has been enslaved to the bibliometric culture. You have to publish in Nature and in Cell and in Science and have high impact and so on, and this periodical certainly doesn't belong there. But nevertheless, this paper is the paper, one of two, that brought us the Nobel Prize, which tells you that what important is what you publish and not where you publish. And there is another point there, which is a little bit funny. It wasn't funny at the time, but my name there is misspelled. It's not the first name, but it's the second name, my last name. You see that the C is missing there because my name is spelled C-I-E-C-H-A. And the C, the second C is missing. The spelling here is C-I-E-H-A. What happened? Happened that my mentor was in the United States. I sent him the data. He wrote the paper. I was a young graduate student. And he sent it to me without proofreading. He sent it to the editor without proofreading. So, okay, so there is a mistake. What's nothing? Well, when I got to my last promotion in my university, and I wrote a whole essay why I think I deserve the promotion, and I also described the paper, then a very important professor in my institute came to me and said, "Aaron, this paper is not yours." So I said, "How comes?" He said, "I'll show you. Let's go to PubMed. Let's go to the computer base, and we'll punch your name, and you'll see that it's not there." Indeed, it's not there. We punched my name, and it's not there. And I said, "How comes? These people in PubMed must be nuts." And he said, "They are not nuts. Maybe it's not yours." I said, "How can it be? You know, we should go to my mentor and ask him who did the work. I mean, somebody with a very similar name, but with a missing C. I didn't even know that it's a missing C." But anyway, we resolved the problem by discovering the... Until that day, I didn't know even that there was a spelling mistake. Again, why I'm telling you the story? Of course, it's kind of a funny story, but it's not so funny because it's, again, showing our enslavement to the bibliometric culture, that we are completely dependent on the computers. We don't read, we don't care. We just go punch names, dig out a number of H factor and impact factor and that, and the rest is out of our interest. So it's also part of this culture. So this is the other story. Anyway, the story started to roll down, and I'll just show you one finding before I will go to the second part of my talk. And that's, we like in biochemistry, the essence is to purify proteins, because you want to, the idea is that if you have a mechanical watch like this one, I always wear a mechanical watch. I hate electric battery-driven watch. I think that mechanisms are very fascinating, and especially that people have made watches along centuries. So I'm an avid watch collector. So if you want to understand how a mechanical watch is working, it's simple. You have to take it away. You have to put a cloth on your table. You have to take a little, small, very thin screwdriver. You have to take all the parts away, put them on the cloth, and then put it back. If you put it back in the right order, and you look at each part, and it works, then you know how it works. The only way to understand the mechanism is to take it apart and put it back together. Otherwise, you'll never understand it. It's the same in biochemistry. You have to take the mechanism apart and then put it, reconstruct it in a test tube together, and that's what we did. So we went to the cold room and we started to fractionate the activity. And just to show you, in the lysate, when you take the whole cytosol of the cell, you get a very nice activity that is, by the way, energy driven. You see, without ATP, there is very little, 1.5. And with ATP, you get 10% of activity. This is another point that we knew I failed to mention, that the system requires energy, which is very strange initially, but again, it's another lesson to learn. Because remember, proteins are a source of energy. We are eating protein as part of our diet in order to get energy. Proteins have 4 kilocalories per gram, right? Lipids have 9, carbohydrates have 4, and proteins also have 4. So why is it that we need to put energy in order to destroy protein if in the stomach, if we ate a good Brazilian steak or cheese or any other protein, we make energy out of proteins? Remember, we make energy when we eat protein for our diet. This is occurring in the cell, inside the cell. And in order to be specific, the cell always uses energy in order to control processes. Because otherwise, if the process would have been like in the stomach, there would have been no cell left in the body. Think about a simple metaphor. You are driving a car. If you are driving a car uphill, of course you have to push the gas. Otherwise, the car will not go. But if you are driving a car downhill, you have two options. One is a one-way option. The one-way option is that you turn off the engine and you lift your leg off the brake, so there is no energy spent. You are not generating any heat. You're not consuming any gas. But this is a one-way option because you are going to crash. In order to drive the car under control downhill, you have to do two things. You have to move the car, to shift the car to a low gear, and to put your leg all the time on the brake. Actually, going downhill will cost you more energy than going uphill. Why? For control. The same is for the cell. In order the cell to control processes, it pays always with one coin, energy. So the process is energy requiring. So when we take the lyset, we get very nice, put ATP, we get very nice proteolytic activity. Forget about the assay, I will not bother you with the assay. Then we wanted to understand the mechanism, so we started to fractionate it on different, according to different biochemical principles, and we got different fractions. So you see that fraction one doesn't have any activity, fraction two doesn't have any activity or little, and we put the two fractions together, then we got the activity back. Then we said, wow, this is a paradigm shift. Really a paradigm shift. Because for those of you who know the world of proteolysis, you need only two for the tango. You need the protease, like trypsin or chymotrypsin, and you need the protein to be degraded. So the two can dance the tango. Here you have three to the tango. We have one, fraction two, and the substrate. So, but remember that fraction one and fraction two are coming from the cell, and each contain 5,000 to 10,000 proteins, because the cell has together 20,000 proteins. We just fractionated it artificially on one column. So nobody told us that fraction one doesn't have 1A and 1B, and 1A doesn't have 1A prime and 1A two primes, and so on and so forth. Anyway, to cut a long story short, I spent most of my PhD in the cold room, fractionating and fractionating and fractionating, and we got about more than 10 fractions, not only one and two, but the real story came into light only in 2000, when the human genome was unraveled. It was a very famous Nature paper that came with the human genome, and it was discovered that the system, our system, contains almost 2,000 proteins. 2,000 proteins, which is almost 10% of the total human genome. So you can imagine that 10% of the total human genome is devoted to garbaging. Think how much the cell pays attention to garbaging. 2,000 proteins, more than it devotes to protein synthesis, more than it devotes to the genetic code altogether. So this just shows you the proportion. Not that it's more important, you cannot compare pears to apples, but it just tells you that garbaging is increasingly, is a fundamentally important process. Now, let me just show you the principles of the system, and then we'll go to medicine. So the principles of the systems are the following. We have a substrate, this wool ball, and the substrate is to be degraded. Typically, substrates are not degraded unless something happens to them. Either they are misfolded, mutated. They have to be recognized by the system. In this case, the substrate is doubly phosphorylated. So the two phosphate groups that are sitting on it, once two phosphate groups are sitting on it, it's being bound to an enzyme that is called E3 or ubiquitin ligase. The ubiquitin ligase takes a small protein called ubiquitin, which is activated by ATP, bound to another enzyme called E1, bound to another enzyme called E2, and then go to the substrate. So ubiquitin is bound covalently to the substrate and marks it for degradation for a downstream big proteolytic process called the proteasome. So basically, ubiquitin is a mark. It's a glue. It binds on one hand to the substrate, on the other hand, it binds to the scissors, and the scissors unfold the protein and cut it into pieces. So ubiquitin is what we call a molecular glue. It's a matchmaker. It brings two together, the substrate and the scissors, it brings them together in order to be cut. And it will do it only on proteins that need to be degraded. And the recognition is by this enzyme called E3. And as I said, out of the 2,000 proteins in the system, this enzyme, the E3, we have more than 800 of those. Why we need so many? In order to recognize the different 20,000 proteins of the cell. So this is the principles of the system. Initially, something happens to the protein. Then it's getting caught by the policeman. Then the policeman handcuffs it by putting ubiquitin on it. And then comes the police car and takes it away to be executed, to finish its life. So the principles are kind of illustrious and, you know, and funny, but it took a long, long, long time to understand mechanistically what's going on. So as I said, in 2000, the full landscape of the system was discovered. Meanwhile, ubiquitin didn't remain alone, and informatics that started also to flourish in the late 90s discovered other proteins that are cousins of ubiquitin. One of them is Sumo, not this big Japanese warrior, but rather another protein called Sumo, a small ubiquitin modifier. It's a cousin of ubiquitin. And after Sumo, the family grew even farther. There are many ubiquitin-like proteins that function, that they're all conjugated. They all work via the same mechanism of conjugating by the signal, but they take the proteins, the target protein, for different functions. So only ubiquitin does it for degradation, but Sumo does it for other functions, and NET does it for other functions, and so on and so forth. And meanwhile, the system has expanded in a big, big way. But let's go to medicine. I think that medicine is very important. Now, if you want to, first of all, why at all the system should be attached to medicine? Why at all to think that there will be diseases that are caused by aberrations? Well, first of all, it's gut feeling. If you have 2,000 proteins, it just cannot be that there is not a single disease that will be attached to them. But that's a gut feeling. That's not sufficient. But think about the world of medicine. The world of medicine is basically the world of numbers, of mathematics. Right? We are all composed of numbers. Our blood pressure is number. Our sight, 6 by 6, is a number. The glucose level, the sugar level, is a number. Everything is a number, right? So proteins also have to be in numbers. They have to be in the right quantity. The number signifies quantity. So hemoglobin must be 15, or between 12 to 16. If it's below, we are suffering from anemia. If it's above, then the blood will become very viscous and will coagulate. And the same for every protein. We are living in numbers. What can happen with the ubiquitin system is that proteins are normally keep a level, that's the green one. If the protein will be excessively degraded, it will become blue, then it will be below. And if the protein somehow will not be degraded, it will become this fat red one. So proteins are behaving exactly like we expect them to behave. And the question, what happens if the protein become either blue or red, if it either excessively degraded or not, or accumulating? And let's go first to cancer, because I think that cancer is the best studied disease in that context. And in cancer, I'm going back to the story of the brakes and the gas. Think about the brakes. What are the brakes of tumors? The brakes of the tumors are proteins that are known as tumor suppressors, right? The most well-studied protein is P53. It's a protein that suppresses tumors. It's basically a quality control check protein. It can see that there is a damage to the DNA, that something happened to the cell, and it will stop the cell cycle, and it will try to attempt to repair the damage. But if it cannot repair the damage, then it will kill the cell by apoptosis. So this is the role of P53. So it's a good protein. We cannot live without P53. It stops cell damage all the time. It protects us from irradiation, from anything, for any damage that occurring to our genome. Now, there is a virus that is well known, which is called the human papilloma virus. And the human papilloma virus causes cancer in women. It causes human uterine cervical carcinoma, right? It hits the epithelium of the cervix of the uterus in women, and it causes cancer. The story is another story of Nobel Prize of Harald Sohausen from Germany from a few years ago. It's a major discovery. Now we immunize women, we immunize girls at the age of 10 to 12 from the virus with the hope that they will be immunized for their life. It's not clear yet, but it's still. So what the virus is doing, the mechanism of the virus, that the virus goes into the cell, and the virus behaves like a robber in the bank. When you want to rob a bank, you're not running to the safe. You're first going to turn off the alarm. And only then you go to the safe, if you don't want to be caught by the police. So the virus is doing it the same. What the virus is doing, the virus encodes a protein that binds to P53, and then the ubiquitin system looks into it and doesn't recognize it, because it's not the normal P53. It's a P53 to which some viral protein was attached. So the ubiquitin system says, this is not me. This is something that should be trashed. And they trash, the ubiquitin system flushes down the sink P53. And that's exactly what the virus wants, because the virus removes the checkpoint, the quality checkpoint proteins, and then it transforms the cell. So it's a two-stage transformation. So this is one mechanism by which cancer can occur, by degrading a good protein. The other mechanism is by upgrading, by not degrading a protein that normally pushes the cell to grow, but under control. So what happens is, think about breast cancer that is caused by mutated EGF receptor. The drug is the Herceptin that we are using. If the EGF receptor that normally let the cell divide but under control now works excessively, it's not degraded, the EGF receptor, the ubiquitin system somehow, because of mutation, doesn't recognize it. It will stimulate and stimulate and stimulate, and that will happen on the left side. So either degradation of a break protein, excessive degradation of a break protein, or under degradation of a gas protein will bring to cancer. So here you can see, in general, in a big way, how degradation of proteins can be involved in cancer pathogenesis. And that's big, because what happens here happens in many cancers, in kidney cancer, in colorectal cancer, in melanoma, in pancreatic cancer. I can enumerate to you numerous cancers in which the ubiquitin system or aberration in degradation occurs. So once you understand the mechanism, you can go and develop drugs. I will not go into all the drugs that are there, but I will show you one of them, the first one. And the first one, I'm getting a note that my time is over, so I will rush. So the first one, the first drug that was developed was in the early 2000s. It's a proteasome inhibitor. It was developed by a company based in Boston, Millennium. And then it was licensed out to Johnson & Johnson, to Takeda. And it's an inhibitor of the proteasome, of the scissors. So it leads to accumulation of proteins, and I'll tell you how the mechanism works. This is the drug, this is the old drug, there are new generations now, I don't want to go into technical problems. It's called Valcade or bortezomib. You can see here, this is The drug is a boronic acid derivative, and it binds to the active site of the enzyme and kills it. The enzyme is not active anymore, so the ubiquitin system is shut down. And the drug is very effective in one type of leukemia, which is called multiple myeloma. It's a B-cell leukemia. It's a leukemia of the immune system. When B-cells are expanding in the bone marrow in an uncontrolled manner, they occupy all the space of the bone marrow, and it's a very bad disease, or used to be a very bad disease, because the bone marrow is now out of function. It doesn't generate red blood cells, so the patient is anemic, is pale, cannot breathe. It doesn't generate white blood cells, so the patient is susceptible to infections. It doesn't generate platelets, so the patient bleeds. And the B cells are also secreting immunoglobulins, so the immunoglobulins clog the kidney, and the patient is suffering from kidney insufficiency. The pressure on the bone marrow and on the bones breaks the bones, so the patient is suffering from fractures. Actually, one of the first complaints is kind of a backache. So the patients are coming to the clinic and they say, oh, doctor, I have a severe backache, and then the doctor sends them to physiotherapy and it doesn't help. Then they come back and they're making CT scan, and then you see the collapsed vertebra. So it's a typical story. And the drug is killing these cells. How it kills them? These cells are a factory of immunoglobulins. They generate a lot of immunoglobulin. So during the generation of immunoglobulins, like in any factory, some proteins are getting out of the production line defective. You know, if you're going to Detroit or to Honda or to Toyota production line, you will see that out of 200 cars, one has some defect. So this car is going out of the production line for either repair or out. So the same is happening to proteins. Proteins are made with mistakes, and we don't want them, so we degrade them. But this cell is a very heavy factory. This cell is an exceptionally big factory, the B cell, for immunoglobulin. So you can imagine that normally a B cell will make 10,000 molecules a minute. But this cell is making 1,000,000 molecules a minute. And you can imagine that normally 1% of the molecules are defective. So if you are making 10,000, so 1% of 10,000 is 100. But if you are making 1,000,000 molecules, then 1% of 1,000,000 is 10,000. So the cell has to cope with 10,000 defective molecules and to degrade them. So the ubiquitin system can still do it. It can deal 100, but it can deal with 10,000 also. But 10,000, it like floats on its nose. If you inhibit the ubiquitin system even partially, it cannot cope anymore with the 10,000, with the excess. And then a reaction is evolving in the cell, which is called the unfolded protein response. It's a stress reaction that at the end kills the cell. So basically, we are using these drugs. It's not a chemotherapy. There are very few side effects. It's a very ingenious drug. It induces cell death by accumulating abnormal proteins in the malignant lymphocyte. That's the mechanism. The drug has changed now. There are new generations with less side effects. This is not the only drug in the market. There are new drugs that are coming. I don't have time to tell you about thalidomide, which is a drug that is going to really change the whole area of treatment of many diseases, including neurodegenerative diseases and cancer that are now untreatable, because it's a much broader platform. So I think that I'm going to end up here with one lesson, I think, about science and about what's going on in science in the world these days. In my country, in Brazil, I'm sure in many countries, people are being pushed to do practical science, to do something that the public will benefit from it, to study cancer, to study agriculture, to do what we call translational or applied science. This is an opposite example. This is an example of science that started with curiosity, with identifying a question that had no horizon, that didn't have any disease or any drug in the radar, but nevertheless became moved into the center stage of medicine, of modern medicine. And the beginning, and we just see it's a multi-billion dollar industry already, the drug industry behind it, and it's going to be a much bigger in the future. So it's an example of how science is behaving. Science, we don't know the secrets of science. We don't know what's behind the corner. We are just doing something, we are studying something, and if it's important, somebody else will take it and further distill it and further distill it and discover another layer and another layer. If you are trying to direct science, it will never work. It's like, I compare it to a rape. You know, we need to have an attitude of love, of care, of softness, to not to expect anything from nature. We cannot expect anything because we don't know. We simply don't know. So we have to let it go. We have to let good scientists do the job, and then good results are guaranteed. If we tell people to do something, you know, we enforce them, we dictate it from by the politicians, by whoever, it will never work. It will never work because we need an internal balance between fundamental discoveries and their application. If everybody will do just applications, there will be no fundamental discoveries, and then the world of no innovation will die out naturally. So I think that the only thing that we should care in science is high quality. The rest will be done by the people. We shouldn't care for more than high quality. So I think that this is a good example of curiosity-driven science that had no diseases and no drugs in the background, but nevertheless developed to become a center stage, not only in understanding the pathogenesis of numerous diseases, but also in bringing cure to them. Thank you very much.
Abriremos agora um momento para perguntas e respostas com a plateia. Para fazer a moderação desse momento, convidamos para retornar ao palco o diretor científico da Nobel Media, Sr. Adam Smith.
So what's now?
This is better. Okay. So we have time for questions, but Aaron, I don't think this is on. It is, okay. Since you mentioned the Velcade story at the end, right at the end, can you just in 1 minute tell people the story of your gift from the Israeli ambassador in 2004?
Yeah, this was an interesting story. As I told you at the beginning, I'm a trained physician, but then I moved to do science, and it was not an easy decision, because medicine is not only important, but it's also a very attractive profession. You treat people, you deal with families, so it has a lot of interesting and humane elements in it. But I decided to do what I do, and that was kind of behind me. When we came to Stockholm in December of 2004 to the Nobel Prize awarding ceremony, it was always in December. The Nobel Prize is always awarded on the 10th of December, which is the anniversary to Alfred Nobel, according to his will. There is also a Jewish holiday at the same time, which is called Hanukkah. The Israeli ambassador gave us a party, and he invited many other ambassadors and guests, the leaders of the Jewish community and so on. And in the middle, this is how it was kind of a private party in his residence. And in the middle of the party, he told us that he has a gift for us, to give us a gift. Of course, I'm always expecting a gift. Why not? So it's nice. My wife hates them because the whole house is like full with this junk. But he said, talk to her every time I go away. She warns me, don't bring anything. So what was the gift? The gift was a human being, walking human being, by the name of Oscar Jonsson. He was Swedish, and he was dying, basically, in the nearby hospital, of the Karolinska Hospital, of multiple myeloma, of the disease that I just told you about. It was basically the end of his life. The priest was already called to the bed to take the last confession, and the physicians heard about an experimental drug, the Velcade, that was still not approved by the FDA, and they flew the drug to Sweden, the first batch of the drug, they flew to Sweden, and they gave it to him, and within 3 weeks, he was walking back on his two legs, healthy, and it was really amazing to see him. You know, he was really healthy. I looked at him, he was not anemic, shook my hand, and he came basically to thank us for saving his life, which is another example of science. We had nothing to do with the drug. I had nothing to do with the drug. I didn't develop it, I didn't study it, nothing. But it shows you that, again, the chain of science, that scientists are doing one step, other scientists are doing another step, they further mature it, and then the companies come and further mature it, and so on and so forth. So it's, again, a wonderful example of how science should be and how science, even in the university, even academic, purely academic, curiosity-driven science, is at the end feeds back to the society that actually maintains us, because all the money that is coming to this university is coming from the public. You are living all on public money, like I do. My university is living completely on public's money. So it was kind of a rare, very touching example of the way that science should be done, and on the fact that science is international. For me, science, I'm living in a country that is ridden with wars, endless wars, in the midst of a fundamentalist Islamic world that is there basically to kill. It's crazy what's going on around us. We are a little villa in this big jungle. But again, it shows you that science also has no limits. You know, the drug that was developed doesn't belong to me, doesn't have any national, religious, gender, sex, whatever limitation. It's a drug, and it's being used all over the world, and even the people that want to kill me now are the people that are using it for their benefit. I think that science, in that sense, is the best language of peace. If people would have spoken the language of science, they would have stopped killing one another at the end, because they would have understood the benefit of science, but unfortunately, it's a very naive dream in this world. But I think that there is many lessons to this little anecdote.
Indeed. Thank you. Thank you. So Aaron, we have our first question here. This gentleman here. Would you speak in Portuguese or English?
Portuguese.
Portuguese, so...
Or I can try in English too. I'd like to ask you, what's the best way to assess a research group in your opinion? For example, in a traditional manner, we consider that if we measure production and citation, we can say this is a good research group, or this is a group that needs improvement. In your opinion, this traditional assessment, like production and citation, that's good, or you value other results?
At the end, the question was again about the bibliometrics that I mentioned, about the citation and so on. Let's imagine that people had to evaluate my work at the time that people objected it. That I was not invited anywhere, that nobody cited us, that nobody funded us, and I had to apply for a job. And there was no citation and no nothing because people didn't believe in it. So basically they would have trashed a treasure. So we need, I think, at the end, yes. After many years that you are in a subject and nobody cites you, it means that something is wrong. If you are into the business for 20 years and nothing comes out, then maybe you are in the wrong business or in the wrong subject. But at the beginning, if you are taking a young scientist or even a mid-career scientist that starts something new and something that is challenging, and the community still hasn't accepted it, but you don't give him an opportunity to assess it, you don't assess it scientifically, you sit with him, you inquire, you see the value, where it can go. Nevertheless, it still doesn't have an impact. You may miss big opportunities. And therefore, I think that we should use numbers, but with it to an extent and after a while, but when we assess people, we should talk to them and we should understand where they are heading. I think that the best way to understand and to evaluate people is to talk to them. Then you can understand their intelligence, their breadth of knowledge, where they are going, how do they think, how they want to tackle obstacles on the way, whether they are preparing alternative routes if they fail. The only way is to talk, rather than to look at numbers. That's my way. It's slower. It takes more time. It keeps you more busy. But that's the only way to discover the truth. I should just use numbers, I will miss a lot.
Thank you. Nick, more questions.
I have another one.
Well, okay. Okay.
In your department, they assess, they evaluate you in this manner? They talk to you, or you just work in your manner, independent of the values of your department?
You're asking me how I run my lab?
No, how are you assessed?
No.
How do they assess you in your department?
Ah, how they assess me? Luckily, they don't have to assess me anymore. I'm out of the business. But when I had to be promoted, I told you about this anecdote with my name. It was the usual, letters of recommendation, worldwide committees, one committee looks at it. Israel is a very cumbersome, but I believe a very good. We adapted the American system, basically. We ask always for help from the outside, because inside, either you have good friends or you have enemies. So you're asking objective people from the outside to send letters. Then there is one committee, then another committee looks at the recommendation of the first committee. We have four committees, and they're all completely independent. They don't talk to one another. They just see the papers of one another. So it looks like an okay system. I wouldn't say that it's ideal, but all academic stuff in Israel is subjected to the same process.
Okay. Any questions from this side over here? I'm being blind. I can't see anyone. Oh, there's one down here. Okay. There's a lady standing over there with a microphone. She's working hard, so somebody has to make use of her. Okay, please go ahead.
Well, you've been talking about a research that's been going on for 40 years. And you said at the beginning you found a very good question. You identified your object of study. You identified maybe where you find it. But over 40 years, you answer one question, you answer another, and you don't really have so much of a big picture. How do you keep motivated? How do you go from one small question to another?
Well, I think that motivation is different from person to person. I'm an adventurist by nature, so I'm a high risk taker. So I try to convince Adam when we are flying to Rio tomorrow or tonight to go to visit the favela, but he refuses. So he's a low risk taker and I'm a high risk taker.
What do you mean? I'm standing here.
I will leave him in the hotel. I will leave him in the hotel and go by myself. So no, but seriously, I mean, it's you want to do something. I think that the best way, really, if you know during the training, before you become independent, is to be trained with good people, because good people are typically high risk takers, because they wouldn't have made it without taking risk. And good people are typically, not always, but you know, it's the rule, they're in good places. I always, yesterday in Sao Paulo, and in this morning, and yesterday in the afternoon, I always recommended young people after the PhD to go away from their country, even if it's a big country like Brazil. Israel is small, so in Israel it's a must. Because if you go to a good institutions, either in Europe or in the United States, I was trained at MIT, so you always you're exposed to new language, to new culture, to new people, and you'll see how people are making major discoveries. And then it immunizes you against frustrations, it teaches you new tools and so on. And then, and I think that it's a good part of the training. And then it makes you, I wouldn't say risk taker, but kind of, it injects some adventurism into your veins. You need to be an adventurist. Because if you walk the paved way, you'll get to the city that the way is going to. You'll never get to something new.
But also in her question was the idea of spending 40 years studying one thing.
Yeah.
And how you maintain that focus and don't get distracted by that thing over there.
Yeah, this is another thing, to be focused. And at least as long as it... Now, of course, I will work on ubiquity the rest of my life now, because it's exploding. There are half a million citations and hundreds of thousands of papers and on the system. So, of course, and drugs and so on. So it became a world of itself. But I think that focusing is also very important, if it's important, because focusing will identify you. You always want to be Mrs. Somebody, Mr. Somebody's, some subject that people will say you are identified with the discovery. And you are identified, because many people are, they have a very broad span of attention. They jump according to, you know, they are under pressure of rumors. Somebody is working, they will go here and they will go there. And then you cannot make a dent. You cannot really break through the wall. If you want to really make an achievement, you need to be really focused. So this is another. But again, it's very general advice, because from time to time your subject is exhausted. So then you need to move to something new. So it's very general. You know, you have to adapt it to the current circumstances.
I guess we really only have time for one more question. Anybody want to ask it? Not you again, no. Okay, yes, this lady here, please. Sorry. I like your enthusiasm, that's good. Hang on just a second.
No way I will hear you without a mic.
No. Have we got another microphone for her? I'm sorry. There's one coming.
I wanted to know, how did you do to formulate your questions and to identify the problem? Like, what process did you use?
How did you formulate your questions and identify your problem? What process did you use to do that?
Yeah, as I told you, it was my mentor, Avram Hershko, that really formulated the question for me, so I was free of that. But together we cracked it down, you know, how to put the experimental system and the reticulocytes and how to do the experiments. This was completely collaborative. I mean, I was a student, which tells you also that students are not doomed. You can be a student and nevertheless. And I think that the Nobel Committee now pays a lot of attention to the second generation. You know, when we got the Nobel Prize, all the three categories in chemistry, in physics, and in medicine, the mentor got it with the student or with the postdoc. So Richard Axel on the smell got it with Linda.
Yeah.
She was his postdoc. I was a graduate student. I got it with my mentor.
David Gross.
And Wilczek got it with David Gross.
Yeah.
And Wilczek was a student of David.
Exactly.
So students, when the committee evaluates that the students are really played a major role and then they continue to work on the subject and contributed to it significantly, it will well be taken into consideration. So the subject itself, I liked it. I was interviewed with many potential mentors. I liked the adventurism, but the question itself was put by Avram, by my mentor.
Thank you very much indeed for your question. I'm afraid I think we really are out of time. It's a shame. I wish we could spend longer, but thank you very much indeed, Aaron, and thank you for your presence.